Great. And now the assistant slides should be running as well. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is David Berger, and I'm helping with the technical side of things. I'd like to remind everyone who's attending that we have simultaneous interpretation for today's event. The interpretation is available in the bottom bar of your meeting tools. It looks like a small globe, and it says interpretation on it. If you click on the globe, you will have an option to select the English or Spanish channels that you would like to use, and you will hear the simultaneous interpretation so that you can follow along. If you have any issues, please let us know in the chat so we can try and help you to access the interpretation. And with that, I'd like to start with a short video.
There are a lot of different types of autonomies. You have autonomies which are territorial autonomies, and you have what you call functional autonomies, which are, could also be called ethnic autonomies. So there are some autonomies which are based on a specific territory, and there are other types of autonomies that are based on... besides that, you have types of autonomies which are exist independent of the states, and you have autonomies which exist parallel with the state structure, and then you have other, still other types of autonomies which are part of the state structure.
Hemos hecho primero el autolinderamiento del territorio de la nación One Piece, el autorreconocimiento y finalmente la autoproclamación. Después de la autoproclamación y la constitución del gobierno territorial, es que notificamos al Estado en mayo del 2017, informando al Estado que existíamos antes de la Constitución de la República Peruana.
Greenland has has a territorial autonomy, which was negotiated between Greenland and Denmark in two rounds. First, up till the Home Rule Agreement, which was inaugurated in 1979, and then latest with the Self-Government Agreement, which is from 2009. And especially the self-government agreement has given us a much more wider autonomy, and actually it includes also the right of the people of Greenland to declare ourselves independent on the basis of a referendum.
Existing autonomies in India have not worked very well. Now for that there are many reasons. There are institutional design problems, institutional capacity problems of both the state and of the existing autonomy. How do we address this? This is a very crucial and deep question that challenges all of us.
Estamos viviendo un riesgo bastante latente, ¿no? Porque a veces la forma de solucionar los problemas es desapareciendo o asesinando a los que en su momento están al frente de esta lucha social. Nos queda bastante claro también a nosotros que es el riesgo, pero más sin embargo creo que es más importante defender lo que por derecho nos corresponde.
Uno de los temas que como comisión, cierto, hemos planteado, y creo que las diversas intervenciones en estos días han confirmado, es cómo avanzar en el derecho a la autonomía y la libre determinación en un contexto actual que nos parece de retroceso de los derechos. Y ahí creo que la Comisión cumple un rol muy importante en, de alguna manera, mantener los estándares que ya se han sido alcanzados e intentar ser como un obstáculo a estos retrocesos para que podamos seguir avanzando hacia el derecho a la libre determinación.
Creo que podemos avanzar trabajando para colaborar en procesos de diálogos propositivos entre pueblos indígenas y gobiernos sobre el tema de autonomía y autogobierno. También vemos que es importante fortalecer la actuación de las instituciones nacionales de derechos humanos en esos procesos nacionales o locales de implementación de la declaración.
the message to governments is for them to look at the positive outcomes of indigenous peoples governing themselves and acknowledge that these are contributions to national development and that indigenous, and stop looking at indigenous peoples as if they are obstacles to national development.
Thank you very much for your patience as we had a technical glitch. I would like to remind all attendees that interpretation, simultaneous interpretation, is available. In the bottom bar along your meeting controls, you have the option to use interpretation. The icon is a globe, and when you click on it, you can select your channel, whether it is English or Spanish, to hear the simultaneous interpretation. Thank you again for your patience, and I would like to hand over to Elsa to formally open the event.
Hello, everybody. I welcome all of you today on behalf of IVGIA from around different time zones at this launch of event for the book Building Indigenous Autonomies that was just published. The book is about building indigenous autonomies as part of indigenous peoples exercising their right to self-determination through the right to autonomy and self-government. Indigenous peoples were self-determined much before the term self-determination was invented in modern times. And from the beginning of their interface with states in recent centuries, indigenous peoples behaved as self-determined sovereign entities. And in fact, historically, states saw them as sovereign and, among other things, concluded treaties with them. When indigenous peoples contacted the UN in the 1970s, one of their most fundamental demands was the recognition of their governance systems and the right to determine their fate and their economic, social, and cultural development. Since the early 80s at the Working Group on Indigenous Populations, they were describing different ways and approaches of governance. The discussions on and around the right to self-determination were among the most passionate, controversial, and profound during the drafting of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. States actually had been reluctant to talk much about the content of self-determination since the 1970s, and their discussions on this at the UN had been rather formalistic, except when it came to indigenous peoples. So we can say, therefore, that through their extraordinary persistence and practice, indigenous peoples have been strengthening, rebuilding, reshaping, and redefining what autonomy, self-governance, and self-determination is today. And this can inspire all of us. IVGIA has accompanied the indigenous peoples around the world on this, documenting, supporting, and advocating their efforts in this area for many decades. IVGIA's work began with the support provided for strengthening of indigenous organizations in the Peruvian Amazon and the community's titling program from 1989 to 2000. These experiences led to technical support work in other countries as well. In November 2015, the first autonomous indigenous government was established in Peru by the Huampis people, covering an area of 1.3 million hectares. The documentation and analysis of these experiences led all to realize that building synergies around autonomies is crucial. Publications were issued workshops organized at various levels, including at the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, and most recently in 2019 in Mexico, bringing together indigenous peoples and the UN, as well as the Organization of American States indigenous-related mechanisms doing work on the subject. The publication we are launching today contains the reports on indigenous autonomies prepared by the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and also by the rapporteur of the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues on this topic. It also contains a number of reflection pieces by indigenous leaders. Our event has two parts. The first part is to present the work done until now by the two UN bodies that I just mentioned. And the second part looks to the future, where we invite international mechanisms to discuss how they can address and strengthen these efforts with indigenous peoples, states, UN agencies, and regional human rights institutions. I would like to remind all of you that you can use the Q&A function to write questions, addressing them to panelists, and panelists, if they wish, can respond in this way as well. So now let me turn to the first part of our event on the work carried by UN mechanisms. And first of all, I would like to invite Mr. Jens Dahl, who is former member and vice chair of the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. Jens Dahl is educated as an anthropologist with special regional focus on the Arctic, which he taught at the University of Copenhagen. He's also former director of IKEA. His last employment was as adjunct professor at the University of Copenhagen, focusing on the role of indigenous peoples in the UN. In 2014, he received the honorary Rink Award for outstanding research in Greenland. Jens, what is the background of the Permanent Forum's involvement on these issues of autonomy and self-government? And could you take us through the main recommendations of the study under the Permanent Forum?
Thank you, Elsa. It began in early 2017 when the members of the Permanent Forum had a discussion on autonomy, and we decided that we should focus on indigenous autonomies. And during the meeting in the ordinary Permanent Forum meeting in 2018, we had this discussion, and there was a suggestion by Chapion Nonengo, and he suggested, which we will hear later on, he suggested that we focused on it in a specific expert group meeting. This we did in January 2018, and it was called Sustainable Development in Territories of Indigenous Peoples. From this came two different initiatives. The one initiative was taken by the Special Rapporteur, and you will hear about her start a little bit later, which specifically focused on the rights of indigenous peoples and the role of the state. Whereas the other suggestion was to the Permanent Forum itself to do a study on indigenous autonomies, which I was authored to do. And in this study, we specifically focused on what could indigenous peoples themselves do? What are available to them? What are the options? The study focuses specifically on the experiences, the backgrounds to the various indigenous autonomies, the options available, and the obstacles that indigenous peoples face when trying to exercise their rights according to international law. On all continents, there are indigenous peoples who have been able to use what they consider as a right of self-determination to establish autonomies in accordance with local, political, and demographic realities. The lesson to be learned is that there is a wide variety of options in order for indigenous peoples to take control of their own destiny. Options that include a wide range of opportunities of which governance structures based on exclusive territorial control are only one. Another one which was mentioned earlier on was the existence of functional autonomies, and this we can come back to. Besides that, there was a discussion, and it is included in the study, on the integration of the state. There are mainly three different ways of integration. One is a kind of independent autonomy, which I think that Jean-Pierre will come back to later on. The other one is parallel autonomy, where you have both the state institutions and indigenous autonomies existing parallel with each other. And then you have indigenous autonomies, which are completely subsumed in the state structure. This is not an either or. There are different aspects of each type of autonomy, which could be included both independent and as a parallel autonomy. What have indigenous peoples done? What are the options and what are the bottlenecks? One of the first thing is to be recognized, recognition. Indigenous peoples need somehow to be recognized. The second issue which we deal with is organizational matters. How do indigenous peoples organize themselves in order to promote autonomy? And the third one is to negotiate. How do we negotiate with the state? How do we do it? There are some indigenous peoples who have negotiated for decades on the Inuit of the Nunavut in Canada, negotiated for, I think, 25 years, and the Sami people also have very long time of negotiation. Then there are, what are the aim of having autonomy? Well, one thing could be to have a public government, but there are other options which you could also have indigenous self-government. And these can exist more or less side by side, but it's an important decision to say, should it be a public government or should it be an indigenous government? If you take Greenland as example, Greenland voted for a public government. Then there are, what kind of agreement should we have? Should we have a comprehensive agreement that includes both political aspects, social aspects, and territorial aspects? Or should we only have land claims agreement, which we have examples of from both United States, Canada, and Peru, for example? Then there is the issue in autonomous governance structure. Should it follow traditional lines of organizing, or should it follow modern state ways of creating governance? And the final thing I want to explain is what we call the platform factor. Because some indigenous, when you negotiate autonomous, indigenous peoples have experience, they don't get everything at once. But we have also experienced that when indigenous autonomies have been established, they have a very important platform from which they can use to further strengthen their autonomy. And then we discussed the implementation. How do we implement it? And there's a long variety of ways of doing it. And then, of course, there are the obstacles. There are many obstacles. There are financial obstacles. There are political obstacles. There are even military obstacles. And these should be dealt with and should also be included when indigenous peoples start to discuss what kind of autonomy. So these are mainly the issues that indigenous peoples have taken into consideration when they want to establish autonomy. So we discussed it in the permanent forum and ended up in doing a few recommendations. The first recommendation we did from this study was that there should be established a dialogue. How do we establish dialogue between indigenous peoples and the state? And there are a number of ways to do this. It could be through commissions, it could be through the elected political representatives, and so on. And the second recommendation, which in my opinion is very important, that was a recommendation to the UN Permanent Forum. The UN Permanent Forum has specific access to the UN agencies. And the Permanent Forum was recommended to take up the discussion on autonomy with the different multilateral institutions and with the different UN agencies. What have you done to promote indigenous autonomy? What can you do? The third recommendation was that we urge the UN institutions and the Permanent Forum to develop guiding principles for the implementation of indigenous people's right to autonomy mm-hmm. and self-government. These mm-hmm. guiding principles. Then there was a recommendation that there should be established a grievance mechanism in each state. Where can indigenous peoples go to complain? Where can indigenous peoples go? What kind of institutions are there that can go? We know from Central and South America, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and there's also the African Commission on Human Rights. And governments in general should be urged to establish such grievance mechanisms both within the state and on a regional level. And finally, there was a recommendation to the state that there should be established monitoring mechanism that could follow specifically the people in voluntary isolation. When we take this up because we consider that people living in voluntary isolation is the most radical form of indigenous autonomy. And how do we monitor the situation for these peoples? So this was mainly a few comments on both the history and the outcome of the study. So thank you, Elsa. I can come back with answering questions.
Hey, thank you so much, Jens, for this very interesting presentation. And now I am glad to invite Ms. Victoria Tauli Corpus, the former UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. She belongs to the Kankanaigorod people of the Cordillera region of the Philippines. Vicky is the founder and executive director of the Teba Foundation and former chair of the Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. Vicky, during your mandate as special rapporteur, you presented a first introductory report to the General Assembly in 2018 on this matter of autonomy. And then in 2019, you presented a report about indigenous peoples' self-determination through autonomy or self-government, which is included in the publication. Could you share with us what were the reactions from your presentations on this to states and the reactions of indigenous peoples and others? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elsa. The paper that I presented to the General Assembly was more of an introductory piece which sort of look at the internal and external aspects of self-determination. You know, as has been mentioned, as you have mentioned in Jens, autonomy and self-government, these have both internal and external aspects as well, because it's not just looking at the situation at the national level, but it's also looking at how the right to self-determination, autonomy, and self-government is also transforming international human rights law as well as national laws. No, and so I cited some of the national laws that clearly recognize the rights of indigenous people to self-determination and autonomy, basically stressed in the meeting that if states recognize autonomy and self-government, this will actually have a very positive impact in realizing genuine nation building, because as some of the constitutions have elaborated, they now, in the past, there used to be like one nation, one language, one culture, that's the framework. But with the assertion of indigenous peoples of their rights to self-determination, now some constitutions recognize their countries are multinational and intercultural and multicultural, no? So that is a big leap in terms of that kind of recognition that has changed that concept of one nation, one state, one culture. And of course, the law, with the existence of these laws, some positive developments have come about in terms of bringing about better peace and also well-being, you know, in the communities of indigenous peoples who are practicing self-determination, self-government, and autonomy. In the bigger report that was presented before the Human Rights Council, it basically also reiterates some of the points that that Jens has stated. But in this report, I also mentioned that, you know, this autonomy and self-government and the right to self-determination is not just a legal concept. It's actually really a framework that defines exactly the demands of indigenous peoples and how they want to be recognized as differentiated and diverse and distinct societies, no? So it has, it is useful, it has implications for the past, the present, and the future, no? In the past, for the implications for the past with this right is that the indigenous peoples have to be the ones who will interpret their own history, no, and their own narratives, insofar as how what they are as distinct societies and what happened, you know, to them during colonization and nation state building. Of course, for the present, for them to identify exactly how this autonomy can be operationalized and how can this really be recognized by the states. And in the future, of course, the way that they are trying to put in place the systems that are the workable for them, as well as the knowledge that is needed and the practices that are needed for them to continue being such, being indigenous peoples. The reaction of the states, actually, you will be surprised. There was no negative response from the states. Actually, all of them do recognize that it's really incumbent upon the states to recognize autonomy or to help promote autonomy, no? But of course, that question always goes back to the issue of financing autonomy, you know, the capacities of the states to be able to do that. So there have been some states who have mentioned that, and that was addressed by the paper, even in the paper where I said that it's crucial that financing autonomy and self-government is an integral part of the work that states have to do. No, and in fact, yeah, I was sort of waiting that there will be some kinds of adverse reactions, but I was surprised because I also mentioned the cases of Mexico, for instance, where in Mexico, you know, the government has, there are indigenous people who have self-declared themselves to be autonomous, and now there are many autonomous municipalities in several states, no? Right. And the Mexican government tried to question that in the courts, but they were defeated, you know, when the Supreme Court made a decision recognizing that autonomy, that indeed these indigenous peoples have the right to autonomy, and that is recognized by the Mexican Constitution. So I think that's, for me, the realization that, you know, we need to continue stating this fact, that, you know, asserting right to self-determination, asserting autonomy and self-government is actually has very huge potentials in terms of transforming the countries where the indigenous peoples are living, and states should regard these efforts as contributing in nation building, because nation building is really looking at the interests of all the people living within those boundaries. As well, the international human rights law should continue, you know, the points that Jens raised, continue monitoring how autonomy and self-government is progressing and addressing the obstacles. And so addressing this to the international community also means that the UN agencies, the programs, the investors really need to take this into account when they are bringing investments into the countries. And dealing with these indigenous peoples as autonomous entities, and not just through a very centralized process of imposition of national laws that are not consulted with indigenous peoples. So I think that's for me, it gives us it sort of shows that for as long as we can can buttress, we can provide the evidence, you know, to our claims that autonomy is going to be good for the country as in general, and of course the government, the states in particular. That I think is what we need to constantly harp when we talk about the advantages of autonomy, but of course to also state the obstacles, you know, the main obstacle, even during the time that we're negotiating the declaration, always, and even here in the country level, always the main obstacle is that we don't have the money to support, you know, these autonomous governments, which is ridiculous as far as I'm concerned, because these areas where indigenous peoples live are also where the resources are coming from as far as the wealth of the government is concerned. So that is an argument that should be debunked in the best ways that we can. So, and of course, I also had several recommendations. Some of these echo what Jens has said, but I stress in the recommendations the need for really financing autonomous setups for changing the laws, national laws, to reflect what is recognized internationally, and of course to really engage in equal with indigenous peoples in a very participatory and inclusive manner, because that is what inclusive and democratic state should be all about. So in a nutshell, that's how my report has been used. Mm-hmm. And I thank all the indigenous peoples who contributed, and the states as well who contributed in coming up with that report.
Thank you so much, Vicky. This is a wonderful presentation of the depth of the question and what you went through in your experience as rapporteur on this. I see that we have just a few minutes, 5 minutes at most, as a moment of Q&A before we go to the next part of our program. And I see that Champion Noningo would like to make a comment. Champion is the technical secretary of the Autonomous Territorial Government of the One Piece Nation. Champion.
Muchas gracias, señorita. Muchas gracias, doctor Jens, señorita Victoria, y a todas y todos los oyentes. Gracias a la convocatoria también. Yo quisiera iniciar mi pequeña intervención agradeciendo a ex relatora especial de las Naciones Unidas sobre Pueblos Indígenas, doctora Vicky Tauli, doctor Jens, dos importantes, muy visibles para la Nación Wampis, que ha simpatizado fuertemente y han, como han mencionado, ha hecho informes al nivel de las Naciones Unidas. Para nosotros este es un aliento muy necesario, importante, y quisiéramos que continúen donde estén. En segundo lugar, yo quisiera aprovechar este pequeño espacio para indicar al público que nos escucha y también invocar a los estados nacionales que las autonomías que estamos promoviendo los pueblos indígenas en el mundo, en vez de ser una amenaza, debe ser tomado como una fortaleza de las naciones del mundo, como una bondad, digamos, como una especie de ayuda al propio Estado Nacional, porque lo que queremos no es destruir al Estado-Nación, no es destruir a la sociedad civil, menos, sino más bien contribuir efectivamente de manera positiva al desarrollo amplio y el desarrollo de la democracia de nuestro país. Eso es, digamos, la aspiración fina y fuerte de la Nación Wampi en mi caso. Y por otro lado, y reconocimiento debido, ¿no?, formalmente, jurídicamente, a nivel interno de las autonomías que promovemos. Eso implica que reconocimiento, además legal, tiene que ser reconocer la inteligencia, la creatividad en las iniciativas de los propios pueblos indígenas para su autodesarrollo económico, social, educativo. En ese sentido, como dice la doctora Tauli, no necesitaríamos tanto dinero, sino como que una facilitación, como un acompañamiento técnico en nuestros proyectos que queremos desarrollar. Entonces, y el mundo, digamos, a nivel de las Naciones Unidas, deberían los Estados miembros reconocer, por lo menos políticamente, que la existencia de las autonomías es una forma de desarrollo de los pueblos indígenas que queremos emprender nuestros propios proyectos, digamos, perfectamente viables, y esto con sinergia del desarrollo nacional de cada país. Eso sería mi invocación, y muchas gracias a las personalidades que nos vienen apoyando. También había las instituciones cooperantes que también siempre nos han apoyado, y quisiéramos continuar en este proceso de diálogo con ustedes y con toda la sociedad civil, y por supuesto con el Foro Permanente y también con las Naciones Unidas a nivel de la Asamblea General. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Champion. And I see another question that Shankar Limbu would like to address. Shankar, could you take the floor? I don't know if this is technically possible right now.
Hi, Elsa.
Hello.
Distinguished panelist, dignitaries, it's a very interesting presentation and a very fruitful presentation. I have a very simple questions that we've been facing. I guess this is the case in the mixed societies. Now, the indigenous territories, it's not only indigenous peoples live in their territory. There are outsiders also, there are other peoples also, it's a mixed communities. However, indigenous peoples in the lack of autonomy and self-governance, they are facing number of discriminations, marginalization and exclusion. So that's why the autonomy and self-governance is at most to share the power and to share the resources. However, there are many, the critics that saying that it's not feasible if there are any that kinds of.
We have lost the voice.
Sorry, there's a technical issue. Shankar will try and rejoin us.
All right, sorry. Maybe
there he is.
Okay, so if there are any good examples that the panelists know, anyone or Zains can respond, that the autonomy in a mixed society, the indigenous autonomy in a mixed society, that is feasible or not? That's my questions.
Thank you very much, Shankar. And I would like to invite our two panelists, if they wish to comment on what we just heard. There are, of course, many more questions in the Q&A, and I invite you panelists to please write up something as time is pressing us. Of course, we can revert to a Q&A at the very end of our event, but I wonder whether Jens and Vicky would like to take up any of the points that were just raised.
Yeah, I would like to say something in relation to respond to Shankar. That's why in the paper that I prepared, I stressed a lot on the importance of intercultural dialogue, no? Interculturality, because that in itself recognizes that there are usually many the other various people living within the territory that is being claimed as an autonomous region, for instance, or an autonomous municipality. And that's the reality for most indigenous peoples, no? Where there are always a mixture of people, because history has moved already, no? So that's precisely why there is a need for intercultural dialogue, which means that there should be mechanisms wherein these kinds of dialogues will be held between the indigenous peoples and the others who are not indigenous, who are living within their own communities, and agreements reach on how an autonomous setup can be built. And usually that's where some autonomies are failing, because it's either, you know, the non-indigenous peoples are being mobilized to fight against the autonomous setup, basically telling them that it will be to their disadvantage if this autonomy is going to happen. That's what happened here in the Cordilleras. You know, in the Philippines, the constitution allowed for the building of Cordillera autonomy, but because there was a lack of education, awareness raising, that was used as a tool to divide the community. So I think it's important for those kinds of intercultural dialogues to be held. And we can see some good examples. I think some of the examples in Mexico that I have seen, you know, I have personally talked with, for instance, the people from Sheran, from Ayutla de Libres in Oaxaca, from Sheran in Michoacan, and they have some good examples of the how they are also involving the others in building the autonomy that they want to build.
Thank you, Vicky. Jens, you would like to make a comment?
Only a few comments, because it's a complicated question, of course. But there are cases where within an autonomy, a territorial autonomy, you have some rights, for example, land rights, which are only allocated for indigenous peoples, whereas other rights are, like political rights, are for everyone living within the territory. But you have also examples that indigenous peoples living outside that territory have some specific rights to vote and within the territory. So it's a complicated issue, but thank you, Shankar, for asking that.
Thank you, Jens. So we move swiftly to the second part of our event. Looking forward, how can we support the implementation of the recommendations that came out of the two reports that we just went through? And I would now like to invite Ms. Anne Nuoram, chairperson of the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. She's a long-term Sami politician and has been member of the Sami Parliament of Finland since the year 2000. Ms. Nuoram is the chair of the VEA Chan Yarga fishery. She has been working on reconciliation issues and now works as the head of the Sami Council's Human Rights Unit. So the question is, how will the Permanent Forum use its unique position in the UN system to help the UN system support indigenous people's efforts regarding autonomies? And will the Permanent Forum ask all relevant agencies to promote country-specific programs in this area?
Thank you, Elsa. And dear Indigenous sisters and brothers, ladies and gentlemen, first I'd like to answer the first question. How will the Permanent Forum use its unique position to urge UN agencies, programs, and funds to promote and support Indigenous autonomies? As Jens mentioned, over the years, the forum has made a number of recommendations to UN agencies, funds, and programs directly related to the right to self-determination, autonomy, and self-governance, to either support member states in recognizing the right to self-determination or issuing specific recommendations to the UN system itself. For example, the 12th session called on member states to ensure that the 2030 development agenda recognize indigenous people's right to self-determination, autonomy, and self-governance, but noted that the role of the UN country teams was crucial, and I will come back to this one. The 16th session in 2017 recommended that the UN system itself adapt policies to inform their work with indigenous peoples that include indigenous peoples' right to self-determination and free, prior, and informed consent. Progress achieved will be discussed at the future sessions of the Permanent Forum. And the Permanent Forum in 2011 called upon UN agencies and intergovernmental agencies to implement policies, procedures, and mechanisms that ensure the right of indigenous peoples to free, prior, and informed consent with their right to self-determination in relations to sovereignty, over natural resources. Recommendations such as these to UN agencies, funds, and programs have seen positive results when collaborative approaches have been taken by forum members to formulating recommendations. Therefore, continuing informal discussions with UN system organizations between forum sessions on their work programs and activities has proven to be fruitful in seeking opportunities for collaboration to advance the rights of indigenous peoples, including the right to self-determination. And the current pandemic has actually proved a virtual platform to hold more in-depth discussions that should be continued post-pandemic as a best practice. We have had lots of different meetings with different UN agencies and programs, funds. And then the second point, how the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and SWOP and Permanent Forum Position, the second question was, will the Permanent Forum ask all relevant agencies to promote country-specific programs to support processes to establish indigenous autonomies? And the system-wide action plan was issued 2015 and provides the framework for action to implement the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples by the UN system. A note issued by the Secretariat for 2020 session of the Permanent Forum outlined the then newly recognized UN development system of resident coordinator offices that now report directly to the UN headquarters and the Deputy Secretary General, with the coordinating office in New York headed by Undersecretary General Robert Piper. The new resident coordinator system and its integrated approach to national implementation that is inclusive of the substantive inputs from offices like the Indigenous Peoples and a Development Branch of DESA, as well as other UN funds and programs in the interagency support group on Indigenous issues. For example, forum members were recently informed that the following discussion in the Secretary General's executive committee this summer on how the UN system can better protect the rights of Indigenous peoples. Several decisions were issued, among which included promoting the establishment by country teams of consultation mechanisms for Indigenous peoples on all national development processes that affect them. And this is, as a matter of fact, for the first time Indigenous rights were decided at this high level, at the executive committee. And these decisions included directions to the UN agencies to provide support to the resident coordinators and UN country teams in the framework of the SWOP, including on protecting Indigenous peoples' collective rights to their lands, territories, and resources, and access to culturally appropriate health services and protection from violence. Also, conduct mapping of existing resources and activities currently devoted to Indigenous peoples at the country level, as well as resource requirements to further strengthen the UN's ability to address the issue at the country level. And third, support the development and implementation of policies to amplify the voices of Indigenous peoples in relevant fora at all levels, and for the protection of Indigenous human rights defenders, as well as sexual violence against Indigenous women. This will be done through an awareness-raising campaign, as well as through efforts to improve access to information, strengthen preventive actions, and ensure remedies for violations. And fourth decision was to support member states in establishing institutions and mechanisms for consultation of Indigenous peoples regarding development plans and projects which affect them, and in particular, those supporting the socioeconomic response to COVID-19. Fifth was to support the establishment of adequate coordination mechanisms to address gender-based violence against Indigenous women and girls. And and which include culturally appropriate prevention and protection measures. Also, the decision was to ensure the inclusion of indigenous peoples in the development and reporting of common country assessments and UN sustainable development frameworks. And also to enhance cooperation between indigenous peoples' representatives and relevant UN nations bodies and mechanisms to take protection measures and follow up to acts of intimidation and reprisals. The forum was also recently briefed that the interagency support group has been working on drafting a call to action on building an inclusive, sustainable, and resilient future for Indigenous peoples for adoption by a body comprised of the heads of all UN agencies, funds, and programs. The focus is on the enhanced implementation of the system-wide action plan to implement the declaration. We hope that this will shortly be adopted. Within the context of new development system, enhanced opportunities to advance the rights of Indigenous peoples, including self-determination and autonomy, are being put in place, and the Permanent Forum will continue its close collaboration with the UN system, both informally and formally through its recommendations, to further promote the policies and programs to make this a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anuaram. Looks like we will have a very rich response from the UN system, hopefully. And now it's my pleasure to turn to Mr. Francisco Calitzai, the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. He's Maya Cactiquel from Guatemala with experience in defending the rights of Indigenous peoples, both in Guatemala and at the level of the UN and the Organization of American States. Francisco was president of the Committee for the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, a treaty body from which he was elected for four consecutive periods of 4 years each. So the question is, how will you be able to follow up on the recommendations of your predecessor regarding this issue of autonomy and self-government?
Thank you very much, Elsa, and thank you very much for the organizers for inviting me to this webinar. And I think that I will continue in Spanish so we can also demonstrate that the multilingual issue is another issue that we have to respect in the right of autonomy and self-determination. Even that the Spanish is not my language, but anyway, it's the national language and it's the only way that we can communicate with others here and especially. Muy bien, muchas gracias. Deseo iniciar especialmente I'm just going to do, okay, I think that is, because I was here in English, so. sí, bueno, muy bien. Deseo iniciar estas ideas sobre el derecho de la libre determinación y autonomía o autogobierno, especialmente dándole seguimiento a las recomendaciones de principalmente de mis dos antecesores, porque fueron ellos los que estudiaron el tema sobre la libre determinación y autonomía. Creo que uno de los estudios que elaboró mi predecesora, la señora Tauri Corpus, habla sobre el derecho a la libre determinación y a la autonomía, autonomía principalmente como una forma del derecho a la libre determinación y al autogobierno. Pero quiero decir, quiero seguir diciendo que el derecho de los pueblos indígenas a la libre determinación ha ocupado un lugar muy importante en el derecho internacional de los derechos humanos. Esencialmente en los años 80, 70, 80, la autonomía fue un tema bastante, bastante discutido, principalmente en el área de las Américas. No voy a hablar sobre la comisión, está mi colega Antonio Urrejola, quien va a hacer un análisis sobre el tema de la región. Sin embargo, quisiera hacer una cuestión histórica de que en los años 70, 80, en las Américas estuvo el tema de la autonomía como un tema de discusión, principalmente en el área de Centroamérica, por las luchas de ¿cómo se llama?, revolucionarias que se dieron en aquel entonces. Sin embargo, cuando, a pesar de que es un tema bastante discutido a nivel internacional y que ocupa un espacio fundamental, como lo decía anteriormente, en el concierto de los derechos humanos, cuando se habla de su reconocimiento como derecho fundamental en los principales instrumentos de derechos humanos, se mira bastante, llamemos, llamativo, se ve como una cuestión de que eso es lo que quieren los pueblos indígenas. Sin embargo, para cuando se solicita a los estados el respeto y ese reconocimiento, pero más todavía, cuando los pueblos indígenas lo practican, James Anaya en el año 2005 lo decía, pero muy bien, y él decía, existe cierto consenso en que la libre determinación es un principio fundamental del ordenamiento jurídico internacional. Pero cuando se trata que los pueblos indígenas lo practiquen, se cuestiona. Más aún cuando se trata de implementar y se solicita a los estados a respetarlo. Esa es una cuestión que creo que es una situación que debemos ver. Los pueblos indígenas en un principio no hablaban de la autonomía y libre determinación. Ellos hablaban de autogobierno, hablaban de su de respeto de su constitución como pueblos indígenas. Y creo que eso es lo esencial en la formación ya de la nueva teoría. Las recomendaciones, a mí lo único que me queda es seguir las recomendaciones hechas por mis antecesores, profundizar sobre la discusión con los pueblos indígenas con respecto a ver dónde se coincide, porque cada pueblo indígena tiene su propia perspectiva y su propia visión sobre lo que es la libre determinación, la autonomía y el autogobierno. En este momento hay una situación bastante importante y es que la base fundamental de una libre determinación, un autogobierno o una o la autonomía, no solamente se puede ver, como lo decía Jan en un principio, solamente como una cuestión de identificación étnica. Yo creo que la autonomía y la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas tiene que estar basada principalmente en el reconocimiento a las tierras y a los territorios de los pueblos indígenas. Porque si no tengo tierras, no tengo territorio, ¿dónde voy a ejercer ese derecho a la libre determinación que tengo como pueblo indígena? Eso es algo, es un principio bastante fundamental. Y creo que el criterio de los pueblos indígenas, como parte y ya lo decía Vicky, son parte fundamental para la creación y el fortalecimiento de los estados, de los países. Y no solo de eso, sino que contribuyen al cuidado del ambiente. Por principio son guardianes de la naturaleza, al considerar a la madre tierra su casa. Son parte de la naturaleza, no dueños de la naturaleza. Es parte de la identidad, es parte de la cosmovisión indígena. Por eso soy del criterio de que la autonomía y el autogobierno y la libre determinación, su base fundamental es la tierra y su territorio. No voy a profundizar mucho sobre la cuestión de los instrumentos internacionales. Hay varios instrumentos internacionales sobre el derecho a la autonomía, a la libre determinación de los pueblos, principalmente de los pueblos en general y de los pueblos indígenas en particular. ya, ¿cómo se llama? Champion hablaba sobre una forma de la práctica de la libre determinación y decir, miren, no queremos dividir a los estados, queremos estar dentro de los estados. Y creo de que ese fue el argumento fundamental para que en los años 90 los estados aceptaran incluir el derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas en la declaración, cuando se les explicó claramente de que no se quería dividir a un país en pequeños paisitos, de que no queríamos una secesión de territorio o del territorio nacional donde estábamos viviendo. Yo creo que ese, volvemos otra vez a la cuestión de que ese es un elemento fundamental en este momento. Por supuesto, hay necesidad de incluir a todas las partes de los pueblos indígenas, en el cual se encuentran los hombres, las mujeres, la juventud, los niños. Todos tienen que participar en la conformación de esa libre determinación. Ya está toda la Carta de Derechos Humanos de las Naciones Unidas, la Declaración sobre la Concesión de la Independencia de los Países Pueblos Coloniales de 1960, la Declaración Relativa a los Principios de Derecho Internacional, referente a las relaciones de amistad y a la cooperación entre los estados en 1970, el Pacto Internacional de Derechos Económicos, Sociales y Culturales, el Pacto Internacional de Derechos Civiles y Políticos en su artículo 1 común, la Declaración y el Programa de Acción de Viena. Creo que son documentos que debemos de profundizar en su conocimiento para poderle dar seguimiento a las recomendaciones de mis antecesores y no solo poder profundizar, sino continuar con la discusión dentro de los organismos de derechos humanos de Naciones Unidas y principalmente dentro del mandato del relator especial para compartir con los pueblos indígenas ese deseo que se tiene de profundizar no solo en el conocimiento, en la práctica de cómo se puede dar, cómo se llama, la autonomía, la libre determinación y el autogobierno. Creo que con esto me quedaría acá, Elsa. Muchas gracias nuevamente por el tiempo. Yo puedo seguir hablando sobre esto porque hay mucho que hablar, hay mucho que discutir, pero creo que con esto lo dejo acá y quiero felicitar a Izquia por este gran paso que dio al dar a conocer este libro, que es un libro fundamental que recomiendo leerlo, porque tiene elementos fundamentales que nos van a ayudar también a todos nosotros a seguir profundizando en el conocimiento al derecho a la libre determinación y la autonomía. Muchas gracias.
Muchísimas gracias a don Francisco. And we are very happy that we are all sharing this passion and desire to go deep and give real implementation to this important right. Now it is my pleasure to turn to Ms. Erika Yamada, who is expert member of the UN Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. She has more than 15 years experience in international human rights law and public policy, and has worked for the Brazilian Federal Body for Indigenous Affairs, FUNAI, focused on land rights, community education, and strengthening Indigenous peoples organizations. Currently, she's a program officer in the Ford Foundation's Brazil office. So the question is, how will the expert mechanism on the rights of Indigenous peoples, through its mandate, follow up on these recommendations of the two other UN reports from the Permanent Forum and the Special Rapporteur, through further studies by MRIP or through integrating this point in the technical assistance that is provided to states by MRIP? Please.
Thank you, Elsa. También voy a hacer mi presentación en español. Quisiera empezar agradeciendo a Evguía por este encuentro, saludar a todos mis colegas expertos de Naciones Unidas, porque hace tanto que no nos encontramos, y a todos los participantes. En un año tan difícil, de tantas pérdidas y transformaciones, de tantas reuniones virtuales y pocos encuentros, casi ningún encuentro, en verdad, es imperativo notar lo importante de estarmos juntos, intercambiando experiencias, reflexiones y visiones. La pandemia ha traído desafíos aún más complejos para los pueblos indígenas, incluso las dificultades de comunicación y la exclusión digital, especialmente en la región donde estoy. En muchas partes del mundo, los pueblos, sus líderes y organizaciones están aún más inseguros, aún más amenazados, y creo que es un compromiso moral de nosotros, que estamos en Naciones Unidas, de no permitir una normalización de esta situación. En septiembre, la Oficina del Alto Comisionado de Derechos Humanos informó que sigue recibiendo informaciones sobre intimidaciones, represalias de activistas y miembros de la sociedad civil y también de pueblos indígenas por su cooperación con Naciones Unidas, mismo en los periodos de restricciones por el COVID-19. Y la oficina está subrayando que los ataques por los medios digitales, la vigilancia digital, la difamación, los casos de torturas y prisiones, bien como el uso de los argumentos y leyes sobre seguridad nacional, las estrategias contra el terrorismo, pone obstáculo o intenta punir a los que traen sus reclames o actúan junto a órganos o espacios internacionales, incluso como lo de las Naciones Unidas, y en especial a los pueblos indígenas y otros grupos que traen a público cuestiones relacionadas a la tierra, recursos naturales y medio ambiente. Esas preocupaciones están publicadas en un informe del secretario general de Naciones Unidas al Consejo de Derechos Humanos y también es una prioridad para el mecanismo de expertos. Yo empiezo trayendo a la luz esta problemática, no solamente porque nos afecta directamente e incluso hemos convivido con situaciones de este tipo en nuestros mecanismos, entre nuestros colegas, pero sobre todo porque la discusión de autonomía y autogobierno pasa por la seguridad de los pueblos y sus líderes y comunidades. Y una seguridad en el territorio, porque es allí que es donde están más vulnerables a los ataques violentos y negarles la voz con seguridad en los espacios internacionales nos parece inadmisible. Entonces es también un llamado a que estemos juntos en eso. Ahora contestando tu pregunta, entiendo que la contribución del mecanismo de expertos sobre derechos de los pueblos indígenas está exactamente en construir la sinergia internacional para avanzar con el reconocimiento y la protección de las autonomías indígenas en los distintos países. Y para mí eso depende mucho de la participación directa indígena de los debates también internacionales y dentro de nuestros mecanismos. De nuestro mandato, subrayo, además de los informes, y de hecho este año presentamos un informe sobre derecho a la tierra, que será un informe de dos partes, uno presentado este año al Consejo de Derechos Humanos y el otro en 2022, que tiene como eje central, como dijo Francisco, el tema de la autonomía relacionado al territorio. Pero además de los informes, subrayo la posibilidad del mecanismo ofrecer a los pueblos indígenas, a las instituciones nacionales de derechos humanos y o a gobiernos nuestra asistencia técnica para avanzar con procesos de implementación de muchas recomendaciones que están no solamente en los informes aquí presentados, pero informes de otros órganos de derechos humanos de Naciones Unidas y también del examen periódico universal para implementar los derechos de los pueblos indígenas como manda la Declaración de Naciones Unidas. Específicamente en el tema de la autonomía, autodeterminación y autogobierno, nuestro rol puede ser el de aproximar las experiencias positivas que fortalecen las evidencias de la importancia del reconocimiento de la autonomía indígena en los procesos de formación de naciones. Este mes vamos a realizar un seminario donde colectamos insumos para un estudio sobre autodeterminación que queremos presentar en el año de 2022 al Consejo de Derechos Humanos. Por fin, quisiera traer una breve reflexión desde mi experiencia en América Latina sobre el tema. Y entiendo que hay dos grandes ejes para la discusión de la garantía de derechos indígenas, de la autonomía y autogobierno en la región. Uno es el de la revisión o aprimoramiento, o aún más, por ejemplo, en caso de Brasil, de no regresión de derechos formalmente reconocidos, en especial en el nivel de los derechos constitucionales para la protección de la diversidad, del multiculturalismo y sobre todo de los derechos originarios indígenas conforme los estándares internacionales que trae la Declaración de Naciones Unidas sobre los Derechos de los Pueblos Indígenas. Y es fácil percibir los distintos niveles de incorporación o mismo de comprensión de qué significa autogobierno o autonomía indígena en los distintos países, solamente para comentar de la región de América Latina. Así que importa también hablar de los procesos democráticos en cada país y la lucha de los pueblos por su inclusión en esos procesos democráticos, de revisión de constitución incluso. En Brasil hemos visto el movimiento indígena en la línea de frente de la lucha democrática de los últimos años, tal vez solamente comparable al movimiento de mujeres, que aquí también se destaca muchísimo. Al mismo tiempo, veo que entre los propios movimientos sociales hay mucho desconocimiento de lo que significa la lucha de los pueblos indígenas en el nivel de la autonomía, autodeterminación y autogobierno. Así que hay trabajo. El segundo eje que quisiera subrayar es el de la implementación efectiva, no solamente formal, de los derechos y del ejercicio de la autonomía y del autogobierno por los pueblos indígenas. Creo que cuando las relaciones con las autoridades estatales son marcadas por la violencia, la exclusión por la omisión, la respuesta autónoma y la búsqueda por soluciones de autogobierno son las alternativas para mantener la cohesión del colectivo, de los pueblos en los territorios. En algunos países, esta relación de los pueblos con el Estado enfrenta todavía los impactos de las políticas anteriores asimilacionistas, bajo una lógica de ofrecer beneficios individuales o familiares que sigue promoviendo divisiones en los territorios y que abren caminos para las tomas de territorios y otras violaciones de derechos. Cuando esta lógica es combatida por los propios pueblos indígenas, vemos muchos ejemplos consistentes de autonomía y autogobierno que pueden añadir a la discusión democrática mucho más allá de los pueblos indígenas, como por ejemplo la construcción de protocolos comunitarios para exigir consultas libres, previas, informadas y garantizar el derecho al consentimiento. Y aquí les comento que en el año 2018 publicamos un informe sobre consentimiento libre, previo, informado. También gustaría subrayar las iniciativas de los pueblos indígenas por la autodemarcación de sus territorios y también ahora de la elaboración de estrategias jurídicas o políticas para la defensa de sus derechos colectivos. Para que tengan una idea, en Brasil, por ejemplo, solamente este año y bajo mucha presión del movimiento indígena, la Suprema Corte reconoció el derecho de petición autónoma a los pueblos indígenas. Entonces, hay un camino muy largo para seguir y espero contar con todos. No sé si tengo tiempo aún, pero quisiera también invitar a todos que participen de nuestra sesión, que será virtual este año. No ocurrió en el mes de julio, donde siempre nos encontramos en Ginebra, pero va a ocurrir en diciembre de este año de manera virtual, en sesiones separadas por región, para que tengan los participantes un contacto más próximo con cada experto de cada una de las regiones. Y la nuestra de América del Sur y Caribe será el día 3 de diciembre a las 3 horas de Ginebra con interpretación. Voy a poner lo de las otras regiones en el chat y invitarles a todos a estar con nosotros porque vamos a discutir el informe sobre derecho de niñez, que será presentado el próximo año, bien como sobre el tema de la autodeterminación. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Erika. And it looks like there is really rich, further rich practice to capture also at the regional level. I know that the report was global and the publication of IFGIA, but perhaps in the future there can be more region specific, so we can thresh out these very interesting initiatives. Let me now turn, and it is my pleasure to invite Ms. Antonia Urejola, Vice President of the Inter-American Commission and Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and of Memory, Truth, and Justice, Rapporteur for Colombia, Ecuador, Nicaragua, and Guyana. Antonia Urejola was elected by the General Assembly of the Organization of American States on 21 June 2017 for a four-year term starting in 2018. So the question is then, how can the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights promote respect for Indigenous people self-government in the region, and how can there be collaboration between the Inter-American Commission system and the UN mechanisms to support Indigenous people's struggle to gain recognition and respect for their self-government demands?
Well, first of all, thank you very much, Elsa. Hello to everybody. Thank you for the invitation. I think this is a very good webinar. We've been in many webinars. Some of us have seen each other with Francisco. We've seen each other a lot, but this is a very, very good opportunity. So first of all, I want to congratulate IHIA for this webinar. I think it is a very important issue, especially in the context of the pandemia. I am also going to speak in Spanish. So now I will swap to Spanish. But I just wanted to say hello to everybody and thank you for this invitation. Como comisionada y relatora de pueblos indígenas de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, para responder a la pregunta de Elsa, yo quería hacer un breve repaso, sé que no es mucho el tiempo, pero ¿cómo ha sido la evolución del reconocimiento al derecho a la libre determinación en el sistema interamericano de derechos humanos? Porque la evolución en el sistema interamericano ha sido distinto a cómo ha sido la evolución del reconocimiento de este derecho en Naciones Unidas. Y para esos efectos, voy a hablar lo que ha sido un poco la evolución de los informes temáticos que ha hecho la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, luego los casos de la jurisprudencia interamericana y muy sucintamente lo que es la Declaración Americana de Derechos Humanos. Desde la perspectiva de los informes temáticos de la Comisión, ha habido una evolución, yo creo, muy, muy importante, pero dispersa, y eso es muy importante señalarlo por lo que voy a decir al final. Puesto que la Comisión ha hecho un reconocimiento a este derecho de manera dispersa y no como de una manera orgánica y sustantiva, y además en algún momento tampoco reconoció el derecho a la libre determinación, y el primer ejemplo, cierto, es el informe 1983, que es referente a los derechos del pueblo misquito en Nicaragua, era sobre la situación de derechos humanos del pueblo misquito en Nicaragua, donde el pueblo, cierto, denunciaba un conjunto de violaciones a sus derechos humanos por parte del Estado, que incluían denuncias relacionadas con la identidad cultural, con su idioma, con el reconocimiento de la religión, y también el reconocimiento a la libre determinación. Y en ese informe de 1983, y es muy importante aquí señalarlo, la Comisión concluyó, y aquí voy a citar textual lo que dijo la Comisión en su momento, señaló que en el estado actual del derecho internacional se ampara solamente el reclamo del pueblo misquito en cuanto a la preservación de su cultura, la práctica de su religión y el uso de su propio idioma, pero que no, el derecho internacional no extendía, ¿cierto?, el reconocimiento al derecho a la libre determinación o autonomía política, que era uno de los reclamos que hacía el pueblo misquito. Es decir, en este informe en 1983 la Comisión no reconoce el derecho a la libre determinación o autonomía para el pueblo misquito. Posteriormente hay otro informe que me parece muy importante, que es el informe del 2009 sobre derechos de los pueblos indígenas y tribales sobre sus tierras ancestrales y recursos naturales. Este informe es muy importante en cuanto se refiere a los avances normativos y jurisprudenciales desde el sistema interamericano en materia de derechos de pueblos indígenas y reconoce la relación directa que existe entre la libre determinación y los derechos de los pueblos indígenas sobre la tierra y los recursos naturales. El informe desarrolla los fundamentos del derecho a la consulta previa y el consentimiento y los vincula con los derechos a la participación, la propiedad colectiva y la identidad cultural. Sin embargo, subrayo, esto es un informe del 2009, el informe omite hacer una referencia explícita al derecho a la libre determinación como tal. Posteriormente, hay un informe del año 2013 que se refiere a los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario y contacto inicial en las Américas, y aquí por primera vez la Comisión va a hablar de manera explícita al derecho a libre determinación. La Comisión señala que una de las premisas fundamentales de los derechos de los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario es el respeto al no contacto y a su elección de permanecer en aislamiento, lo cual es una manifestación al derecho a la libre determinación. Para los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario y contacto inicial, la Comisión señala en este informe que el derecho a la libre determinación tiene una relación directa y profunda con los derechos sobre sus tierras, territorios y recursos naturales. Es decir, este informe sí reconoce el derecho a la libre determinación como un derecho fundamental para los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario. Es decir, elabora este derecho, pero circunscrito al derecho a los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario y contacto inicial. Hay otro informe de la Comisión del 2015 sobre pueblos indígenas y comunidades afrodescendientes e industria extractiva, donde se desarrolla de manera muy detallada los distintos estándares respecto de elementos que son propios del derecho a la libre determinación, como por ejemplo el derecho a la consulta previa, el derecho al consentimiento previo, el acceso a los recursos naturales, etc. Pero una vez más, aquí la Comisión no hace una referencia al derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas como un derecho autónomo y por lo tanto tampoco lo desarrolla. ¿Cuándo la Comisión va a desarrollar de manera más específica el derecho de los pueblos indígenas a la libre determinación? Recién en su informe del 2019 sobre la situación de los pueblos indígenas y tribales en la Panamazonía. Aquí la Comisión va a profundizar sobre este derecho de manera explícita, reconociendo el derecho a la libre determinación como un estándar, pero además el informe tiene un apartado específico sobre la relación entre el derecho a la libre determinación y la consulta previa libre e informada. Básicamente este informe, que es el primero que establece, ¿cierto?, una visión más sistemática sobre el derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas, el informe señala, y voy a hacer muy rápido en aras del tiempo, primero señala que los pueblos indígenas, como sociedades preexistentes al establecimiento de las fronteras estatales, son titulares del derecho colectivo a la libre determinación y desarrolla el concepto. Por otra parte, reconoce que este derecho es una premisa fundamental para el ejercicio pleno de otros derechos humanos de los pueblos indígenas, tanto derechos individuales como colectivos. El informe señala que la imposición de actividades extractivas y megaproyectos de desarrollo sin el consentimiento previo, libre e informado de los pueblos indígenas supone la vulneración a su derecho a la libre determinación. El informe desarrolla, por otra parte, la situación específica de los pueblos indígenas en situación de aislamiento y contacto inicial y establece que la libre determinación supone el respeto de sus mecanismos de supervivencia física y cultural. Tiene un capítulo especial respecto a los pueblos indígenas en contacto inicial. Finalmente, cierto, el informe reconoce que el derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas tiene una estrecha relación con el uso y disposición de las tierras y territorio y señala que el Estado tiene la obligación de adoptar medidas especiales para reconocer, respetar, proteger y garantizar el derecho a la propiedad comunal de los miembros de las comunidades indígenas y tribales sobre dicho territorio. Y posteriormente lo que hace el informe es desarrollar en qué consisten estas obligaciones de los Estados en relación al reconocer este derecho a la libre determinación con el uso y disposición de las tierras y territorio. Por otra parte, eso respecto de los informes temáticos, y ahí subrayo y invito a quienes están escuchando a que lean este informe de la Panamazonía, porque es la primera vez que la Comisión reconoce como un estándar el derecho a la libre determinación y desarrolla el concepto. Por otra parte, respecto a la jurisprudencia interamericana y los casos que ha conocido la Corte, quiero relevar algunos casos fundamentales. Aquí también ha habido una evolución sobre el reconocimiento al derecho a libre determinación. Sin lugar a dudas, el hito fundamental en este caso es el del pueblo Saramaca con Surinam del 2007. Al pronunciarse sobre el derecho a la consulta previa, libre e informada, la Corte subrayó que este derecho a la consulta previa no solo se deriva del convenio 169 de la OIT, que Surinam no ha ratificado, sino que dice explícitamente que el derecho a la consulta previa es inherente a la libre determinación indígena que está contenida en el artículo primero del Pacto de Derechos Civiles y Políticos de la ONU. Luego, el caso del pueblo Sarayacu con Ecuador, del 2012, la Corte es aún más enfática y se pronuncia, ¿cierto?, sobre el vínculo entre los derechos territoriales indígenas y el derecho a la libre determinación. Y esta sentencia resalta que este vínculo es indisociable a la identidad cultural de los pueblos indígenas. Ahí también no quiero detenerme, pero este caso es muy importante en el desarrollo sobre el concepto de libre determinación relacionado con la identidad cultural de los pueblos indígenas. Otro caso importante para resaltar es el de los pueblos Kalin y Locono con Surinam, donde la Corte aquí señala que el derecho a la propiedad colectiva de los pueblos indígenas debe ser interpretado a la luz de las obligaciones previstas en el artículo primero del Pacto de Derechos Económicos, Sociales y Culturales de la ONU, que precisamente se refiere al derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos, es decir, así como el caso Saramaca hace un reenvío al artículo primero del Pacto de Derechos Civiles y Políticos para establecer el derecho a la consulta. En el caso de Kalin y Locono, la Corte hace un reenvío al artículo primero del Pacto de Derechos Económicos, Sociales y Culturales para reconocer el derecho a la propiedad comunitaria de los pueblos indígenas. Finalmente, sobre la jurisprudencia interamericana, va a ser muy importante un caso que la Comisión acaba de enviar a la Corte, que es el caso Tagaeri Taromename respecto a Ecuador. Este es el primer caso del sistema interamericano relativo a pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario. Y el caso se refiere a la responsabilidad internacional del Estado ecuatoriano por una serie de violaciones a los derechos de los pueblos indígenas Tagaeri, Taromename y sus miembros en el marco de proyectos que afectan sus territorios, recursos naturales y modos de vida. Entre otras cosas, porque no me quiero detener, pero entre otras cosas, ¿qué es lo que estableció la Comisión en este caso? Estableció que tomando en consideración el principio de no contacto y el de la autodeterminación de los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario, no es posible intervenir sus territorios para el aprovechamiento económico cuando ello pueda entrar en tensión con la salvaguardia de su subsistencia. Por lo tanto, me he referido muy rápidamente a lo que ha sido la evolución del derecho a la libre determinación desde la perspectiva de los informes temáticos de la Comisión, por otra parte, muy rápidamente lo que ha sido la jurisprudencia de la Corte en la materia, y por otra parte, muy rápidamente, ¿cierto?, es muy importante señalar la Declaración Americana sobre Derechos de los Pueblos Indígenas, que reconoce el derecho de los pueblos indígenas a la libre determinación en su artículo tercero, y además, como una manifestación a este derecho a la libre determinación, reconoce el derecho de los pueblos indígenas al desarrollo en su artículo 29, que también es un artículo muy importante para efectos del tema que estamos discutiendo hoy día. Es decir, para concluir, ¿cierto?, a través de sus distintos mecanismos, la Comisión Interamericana ha venido realizando y aplicando los estándares internacionales sobre los derechos de los pueblos indígenas y tribales. Esto ha permitido desarrollar y dar contenido a los estándares relacionados con los derechos colectivos e individuales de los pueblos indígenas y tribales en materias tales como el derecho a la identidad cultural, la vida e integridad, el derecho a la personalidad jurídica, el derecho a la propiedad colectiva, a la consulta libre, previa e informada, a la participación política, a los derechos económicos, sociales, culturales y ambientales. Todo esto, todos estos estándares que ha desarrollado el sistema interamericano, ha contribuido a una rica y extensa jurisprudencia. Sin embargo, a pesar de esta evolución jurisprudencial respecto a estos elementos fundamentales que acabo de mencionar, y que sin duda forman parte del derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas, este derecho como tal aún no ha sido desarrollado con el mismo nivel de profundidad por parte de los órganos del Sistema Interamericano de Derechos Humanos. Y sobre este tema, la Comisión en estos últimos años y a través de su monitoreo ha tomado en nota de los esfuerzos de los pueblos indígenas de poder realizar este derecho y del apoyo que los propios pueblos indígenas le han solicitado a los organismos internacionales de derechos humanos respecto al reconocimiento de su derecho a la libre determinación. Y es en ese contexto y por toda la evolución que yo acabo de señalar que el Pleno de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos hace un par de semanas recién, acaba de aprobar la elaboración de un informe temático precisamente sobre el derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas y tribales que vamos a trabajar durante el 2021. ¿Y cuál es el objetivo de este informe? Muy sucintamente, por una parte, aclarar y desarrollar los estándares internacionales relativos al derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas y tribales dentro del sistema interamericano de derechos humanos. Otro importante objetivo será fijar una postura definitiva de la Comisión respecto a este derecho en virtud, cierto, de las conclusiones de la comisión en el informe del 83 que yo señalé sobre el pueblo miskito, donde se dice que los pueblos indígenas no tienen un derecho a la libre determinación y la autonomía. Es muy importante que esta visión de la comisión, que es del año 83, sea corregida y actualizada. El informe propone identificar y analizar los elementos que constituyen el derecho a la libre determinación y que se encuentran no solo en la jurisprudencia y los instrumentos del sistema interamericano de derechos humanos, sino que también cómo se ha desarrollado este derecho a través de las diversas fuentes del sistema universal de derechos humanos para reforzar el marco jurídico que fundamenta el derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas y tribales y aclarar cuáles son las características, el contenido y alcance de este derecho. El informe incluirá una discusión sobre algunas prácticas y experiencias que los propios pueblos indígenas han realizado en el ejercicio de su derecho a la libre determinación, cuáles son los obstáculos y desafíos que ellos han encontrado para el ejercicio de estos derechos. Por lo tanto, me parece que este informe va a contribuir a visibilizar prácticas y experiencias que pueden servir de referencias positivas para los pueblos indígenas y tribales en la región, y además el informe le realizará un conjunto de recomendaciones a los estados para que precisamente se reconozca e implemente este derecho. Solamente como una reflexión final, y con esto termino, me parece cierto que el tema que hoy día estamos viendo es muy importante, y es muy importante estar atentos a los elementos centrales del derecho a la libre determinación de los pueblos indígenas. Estos, sin lugar a dudas, han sido reconocidos en los diversos instrumentos internacionales de derechos humanos y que han sido ratificados por la mayoría de los estados de la región. ¿Y por qué es tan importante, cierto? Son tan importantes los elementos del derecho a la libre determinación. ¿Por qué es relevante discutir este tema? En primer lugar, porque los pueblos indígenas, en tanto colectivos diferenciados, requieren de la toma de decisiones para proyectarse como un conglomerado político. Y en segundo lugar, porque su ejercicio, el ejercicio del derecho a la libre determinación, condiciona su propia supervivencia física y cultural como pueblos diferenciados del resto de las sociedades. El caso de los pueblos indígenas en aislamiento voluntario y contacto inicial probablemente es el mejor ejemplo, y la situación que han vivido los pueblos indígenas durante la pandemia no hace sino además ratificar esto. Ahora, sin lugar a dudas, ¿cuál es el principal desafío que tanto el sistema interamericano como el sistema universal encuentran respecto al derecho a la libre determinación? Es lo que se refería a Erika, que es la brecha de implementación, la distancia entre los derechos que han sido reconocidos tanto en los instrumentos internacionales de derechos humanos como también en muchas constituciones y legislaciones nacionales, pero la distancia entre ese reconocimiento internacional o constitucional y legal y la implementación efectiva de este derecho en las políticas públicas por parte de los estados. Por lo tanto, tenemos que reconocer que a pesar de la existencia de estándares claros y toda esta evolución, existen problemas estructurales que afectan el ejercicio de los derechos de los pueblos indígenas y que requieren de una atención urgente por parte de los estados, por parte de la sociedad como global, y también por los organismos internacionales, tanto del sistema interamericano como del sistema universal. La supervivencia física y cultural de los pueblos indígenas depende de un diálogo intercultural, del compromiso de la sociedad no indígena también con los derechos de los pueblos indígenas, y el desafío, cierto, actual no es solo esta brecha de implementación a la cual se refería Erika, sino que también, lamentablemente, el contexto actual que estamos viendo, ¿cierto?, y que muchos de mis antecesores y antecesoras han referido, que el actual contexto de retrocesos que hemos visto en diversos países de la región y el continente y el mundo en relación al reconocimiento de los derechos de los pueblos indígenas. Con esto termino. Muchas gracias.
Thank you so much, Antonia. And this, really, your statement shows how this intercultural debate has to happen also among regions. So I would like, I know our time is up, but I received special permission from Evgia just to extend a couple of minutes. And I would like to ask one question that perhaps you and Francisco can think about, and then also recognize Gam Shimroy from Asian Indigenous Peoples Pact. So the question is precisely this: how can the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and the Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples of the United Nations, how can they connect with the African Commission on Human and Peoples Rights in order to support and help Indigenous peoples' autonomy and self-government in Africa? And while you are thinking of that, let me one moment give really for one moment the floor to Gam Shim Roy. Gam.
Thank you very much, Elsa. From my side, of course, in Asia, the situation is not so different in terms of the political problems that we're facing, but perhaps quite intense at this point of time that is, we're experiencing in many countries. But just to say that maybe my view would be that whether the permanent forum, special rapporteurs and mandate holders can facilitate some kind of discussions specific to the regions in terms of what this autonomy should look like and how it can work with the state in conjunction. Because UNDRIP is there, but UNDRIP is not going against the Universal Declaration of the Rights. Similarly, indigenous peoples are also not going against the state, but we are yet to be part of the state administrative and institutional system. And in that, we still haven't found a way as to how we can fit into that state system. So I think there are many aspects of institutional design problems within the state that is not allowing a kind of a proper autonomy for indigenous peoples to be functioning within. So in that line, I know time is up, so I will just end there to say that it would be important, I think, if possible, to bring back some of the discussion because it's very difficult locally at the moment between governments and indigenous peoples and whether permanent forum can take initiatives and also the special rapporteur and so on to facilitate that kind of a dialogue. Thank you very much for the time, Elsa.
Thank you so much, Gam. And can I revert, can I go back to Antonia and Francisco if they wish to address this issue of collaboration with the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. Francisco?
Okay, I think that what really matters here is how indigenous people recognize themselves as an indigenous peoples. But my mandate is asking me to coordinate with all regional bodies of human rights. And I think that that is the base of how we can collaborate with the African human rights as a human right, regional human right body. And I think that that's why with Antonia, we have been trying to collaborate among ourselves. And at least for next year will be my priority, Africa in Asia. So that's why I was, I'm so happy that you asked that question because I just wanted to tell everybody that that will be my priority, but also already I received an invitation from them. Okay. And I am just going to participate with them. So I think that that is very important. And also I thank IFKIA because I receive the invitation from them, but they also send the invitation through IFKIA because they know that we are collaborating among ourselves. So thank you.
This is great confirmation that we are all a big family. I don't know if Antonia would like to say something about this.
No, just to stress out that, the commission, we try not on the point of indigenous people, but we do have a lot of collaboration with the African Commission on Human Rights. We have been, for example, during the pandemic, having some meetings with them and webinars. We always try to stretch out to different mechanisms. Of course, we work much more with the United Nations mechanisms and, well, with Francisco, we have a permanent dialogue and not as much with the African Commission, but I think it's very important that the different mechanisms try to look for collaboration because some standards, of course, the realities are different. There are cultural differences also, but some standards are the same. And in that way, I think that in Spanish, you say the union makes a force, la unión hace la fuerza,
And I think that's the most important thing. And in that sense, I think it's very important that we stretch out with different mechanisms, regional mechanisms. And also I think that the collaboration like IHEA does, you know, the meeting we're having today is very important for the collaboration, because we start a dialogue and we start seeing the common grounds. And starting from common grounds, we can do some collaboration and work together on those common grounds. So I think that's the way we can work. But I just wanted to stress out that regarding your specific question about the African Commission, we do have a relationship with them and we do collaborate in different instances. Of course, the realities are a bit different, but we do have a collaboration with them too. And we had like a month ago, for example, a webinar regarding the COVID, the pandemic, but I hadn't thought about discussing about indigenous issues. So I take note of that. Maybe it would be a good idea to do something with them too on those regards. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Antonia. And I have to say that this has been such a rich discussion. I saw many questions in the question part, and perhaps some of the panelists could address them. I don't know if there is any closing comment that any of the panelists would like to make. I want to give this opportunity, although we are out of time. Sorry for that. But it's the richness, of course, of the topic, and I hope there will be much more. Is there any other? Yes, Anuaram, please.
Thank you. Indeed, human rights in the kitchen. I'm middle of the renovation of my flat. Okay, yes. About the permanent forum and what we could do about autonomies. As Jens mentioned, he wrote a study on this very important study on autonomy and indigenous peoples. And our theme for the next session is SDG 17, peace, access to justice and strong institutions. Mm-hmm. So we are going to discuss autonomies, indigenous autonomies is going to be one of the discussion topic for the next session, although we don't know how the next session is organized. So there we ask your patience to see how the COVID-19 develops. But anyway, the Permanent Forum has launched a series of webinars, and they are regional series of webinars. So we have started last week with Latin American region. We organized two webinars, and the Permanent Forum members lead the discussions, and they are kind of preparation for the next session. So that the still six regions, regional dialogues are going to be organized by our members. And then we also have thematic preparation for the session, and those are yet to be planned about which themes, but they will take place during beginning of next year. And then there was a question about what Permanent Forum can initiate. And I think that this recommendation made by Jens, sorry about the phone call, Jens Dahl in his study about the guidelines, wait a second, where was it?
Yes.
Development of guiding principles for the implementation of indigenous people's rights to autonomy and self-governance, that would be very useful for the whole system. And when you look at the development of the reform of the country offices and the whole UN, that would be very useful for the whole system. So I think that that recommendation was very timely. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Is there somebody else who would like to say something from our panelists? Okay. I don't see anybody else. Sorry, Erica, please.
Just to reinforce.
And Vicky.
The invitation solamente para encorajar a que recibamos más solicitudes indígenas para nuestras actividades en países de asistencia técnica, y he colocado en el chat el link para las instrucciones para esas solicitudes y el email. Gracias.
Gracias, Erika. Vicky. Vicky, can you unmute, please? Can you please unmute yourself?
Sorry. Yeah, just there were questions in the chat, in the question and answer, like a question from Indonesia saying, how can you promote autonomy in a situation where the government considers everybody indigenous, no? And I think there are many ways of really dealing with that. I mean, even in India, for instance, they say they are all indigenous and all that. But still in their laws, they do have recognition of the existence of Adivasis. And in Indonesia, they also have a constitutional court decision that indigenous peoples, that the peoples living in forests have rights, have customary rights to those forests. So I think what we need to do is to be more creative in terms of looking for the existing laws that we can use to further strengthen our assertion of our right to be indigenous and our right to be autonomous or to have our own self-government. And secondly, you know, I mean, there is this thing they call the de facto autonomy, no, where indigenous peoples basically are the ones governing themselves, even if there is an existing government structure. Parallel to that, there are existing indigenous structures that in fact are more operational than the government structure. So I think there's also a need to look into those and strengthen them.
Okay. Thank you very much, and I see Francisco.
No, I'm just going to say that this issue, self-determination, mm-hmm. autonomy, and self-government is very important inside the crisis that had been created COVID-19, and Canada. The native people from Canada have been demonstrated that the closures of the borders of their community as response of the COVID-19 and uphold the principle of self-determination, in which indigenous people have the right to determine their own path toward healing and health of their communities. So that is something that we have to take in account in this moment, because it's very important that it's taking my attention when a crisis is getting like COVID-19, indigenous people immediately starting to practice their own right of self-determination. So I think that we have to take in account. Thank you very much, Elsa.
Yes. Thank you so much. To everybody. And I have to say, I want to revert in closing to a word that I have seen Francisco use in the back cover of the publication, of the Guia publication. He mentions the word legitimization of indigenous people's right to self-determination, that this book, this exchange of experiences, these discussions just show what an enriching concept this is actually. And as Vicky said in that video that Evgia showed us, you know, indigenous peoples are making their contributions and they have to be seen like that and not as something negative. Actually, it's very good for the world and for the broader society where they live. So with these words, I want to really congratulate all the panelists and Evgia for really making so clear that we need to further build on these synergies around this. And I think we have reached a very nice point now. And hearing from the mechanisms of the international mechanisms, I am full of optimism, actually, that there is a lot that is now unfolding on this topic. And so I'm extremely happy that we did this, that this book exists, and especially that all this work exists that indigenous peoples are doing on the ground, because that's what matters most. So with these few words, thank you everybody, and thank to everybody that has participated to this webinar. And I hope Evgia will soon put the link also up so that we can all watch it at our leisure. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Be well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Keep well.
Bye.
Bye.
A link to the presentation and a recording will be available on IFGIA's Facebook immediately. And then a recording with the simultaneous interpretation will be posted within one day to our YouTube. Thank you, everyone, for this fantastic presentation.
Great. Thank you. Bye.